Well, I'm the product of an Italian mother and a Hispanic father, immigrants to this country, and they raised four boys, and two of us, Angelo and Frank, served in World War II on Iwo Jima and Okinawa. Joseph was just ahead of me, and he served in Korea. I had a very patient father who used to throw tennis balls at me all the time when I was a little puppy. And eventually I just started falling in love with baseball. I played a little bit of double A. And then I just started to have a little trouble with the eyes. I didn't realize they were going. I couldn't pick up the slider worth a darn. And then I said, okay, that's it. I don't think I can push on. And I went back home brokenhearted. The old man says, God, how many kids really get that far? Look at it that way.
Though a career in the major leagues was not destined to be, Jay Vargas nevertheless became part of an auspicious legacy as the youngest of four brothers to serve in the U.S. Marine Corps during wartime. During the second of his two tours in Vietnam, the young company commander would find himself in a life and death struggle in the village of Dai Do, near the demilitarized zone.
The second tour, I came back during Tet, and that's when North Vietnam decided to come down. And upon arriving the second time, it was full-blown. And we knew that the North Vietnamese were coming. My battalion, the 2nd Battalion, 4th Marines, were along the coast. We were up north along the DMZ. And the 320th Division was coming down, full blast, 10, 15,000. Well-groomed, well-trained, well-equipped. I think their mission was to take over Dong Ha, the 3rd Marine Division headquarters. And it just so happened, we kind of got between Dong Ha and in the village of Dai Do and the 320th Division. We were coming down to the new position, the base camp, and I had to march for about, it took us about 5 or 6 hours to a night retrograde. We were receiving maybe 300 or 400 rounds of artillery was coming on us. We marched throughout the night, and we finally got in the base camp, and I didn't lose anyone, but we were all, I had one leg messed up, and everyone had shrapnel in them. So we made it into base camp, and at 4 o'clock in the morning, I was told that you're going to be getting aboard some landing craft, and you're going to go down the Quaviet River towards Dai Do. And no one had slept now for 36 hours. So we went down on the two river boats. We were being fired at, and my battalion commander came and gave me my orders. Two of our companies were hurt pretty bad, and my mission was to go through everybody. And the minute you land at Dai Do, I want you to continue and push on through. One of my platoons, 2nd platoon, got pinned down by heavy machine guns. In fact, we all got pinned down about, we were probably 3/4 of the way through the rice paddies, and we couldn't move anymore. And I don't know what I said. Okay, give me 4 Marines. I'm gonna go up and take the machine guns. So I went forward with 4 Marines, and they got hit immediately. So I ended up all by myself up there. But I knocked out 3 heavy machine guns and killed 14 in the trenches that I got hold of. And that opened us up, and we came through and continued the attack. Got all my wounded, and I lost 3 boys that day, 3 tough Marines. But I got them out of there with helicopters and so forth, and we thought we had secured Dai Do. But the NVA decided to counterattack. So they pushed my company into a cemetery, and we got surrounded and cut off completely. Yeah, I was down to 80 at that stage. And I said, the only way we can survive, guys, is to dig up the graves and throw the bodies out. Now, keep in mind, my Marines haven't slept yet. None of us have. So this is probably 48 hours that no one had even closed their eyes. It was just continual fire. The NVA knew that we were surrounded. They had us good. And nobody could help me, you know. Everybody was said, they're not going to make it. And everybody wrote us off. I had Westmoreland called on the tack line and talked to me. And John McCain, Admiral McCain, John McCain's, Senator McCain's father, He gave me probably one of the best motivational talks I've ever received in my life. And he says, Jay, I know those other guys are probably think they're going to write you off, and everyone's saying you're not going to make it, you and your 80 Marines. And he says, but you're going to make it. He says, I've got all these little toys out here, and that was his ships, the gunfire ships. And he says, you're my priority. So whatever you want to do, build a circle of steel around you, which I did, with aircraft and artillery and naval gunfire. But by throwing those bodies out, getting in those holes and setting a 360-degree defensive position, we fought hand and glove and bayonets and everything all night. After 3 days, we went forward again, but the NVA realized they couldn't go back anymore because they were getting annihilated by the fixed wing and the artillery. So they counterattacked, and that's when Colonel Weiss came up and kind of fell in the trench with me. He says, what the hell's going on, Jay? And he was always up front with us anyway. And I said, you better get out of here because I've called artillery on myself and my Marines, and they know it. And I told my Marines, I said, hey, grab your butts because I'm bringing it in. The colonel turned around, and just as he turned around, he took 3 shots in the spine. My 2 radio operators took shots in their head immediately. And so I was had the air control. I was bringing in the fixed wing, and I was bringing in artillery and naval gunfire. So I had 3 radios in my hand, and my radio operators were already dead. But it was time to kind of retrograde.
Despite his own serious injuries, Vargas dragged his wounded battalion commander nearly 100 yards through withering fire to a covered position. He continued to coordinate his remaining Marines' defensive actions and call in deadly airstrikes until the attacking North Vietnamese were finally silenced.
I lost 7 in my company. Everyone else was wounded, but we got them out. We lost our battalion in 3 days. We lost 86. We killed 2,000. Well, that was a lot of bodies, you know. One thing I didn't like is you had to, you know, the troops had to search pockets every once in a while when you knocked one down, and you'd find a laundry ticket from Hanoi, you know. And I'm going, Jesus, guy came all the way from Hanoi and he's got a laundry ticket here, and he's thousands of miles from his doggone home. You find pictures of their wives and children, and that gets to you. I was given 3 golden rules by my brothers about being a good Marine. And I've used it all my life. And the first one, they said, always set a good example, set your standards high, and take care of your men was 2. Always take care of your men, regardless of whether it's peacetime or combat. And 3 was a tough one. And that was their golden rule was, never ask a Marine to do something you wouldn't do yourself. There were 38 of us in my company that came out of that 3-day battle. And it didn't matter whether, you know, I was the company commander or a private. We were that tight, and we'd proven ourselves. And I found that when you prove yourself, that you'll give up your own life for your trooper. They know that. And they'll follow you through the gates of hell. When I put my medal on, I can't stop thinking about the troops. I can't. And I tell them, I said, when I put this thing on and I have trouble buttoning it, I still shake. But I wear it with pride. And basically in honor of them. It's been 39 years since I've even talked about this. I feel good. I let it out.